Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I intend to make my presentation basically to give you an introduction on the electricity sector of Sri Lanka, and then I will talk a little about the existing legal and regulatory framework in relation to the cross-border trade. And thirdly, I will touch upon the proposed India-Sri Lanka interconnection, because this is the only feasibility interconnection for Sri Lanka to connect with all what we discussed here over yesterday and today. The Sri Lanka electricity sector is basically dominated by one government-owned corporation, which owns about 60% of the generation, entire transmission, and about 85% of the distribution. Where this utility is called Ceylon Electricity Board, where they have four licensed distribution areas, one transmission and one generation license. And also, there is a company called Lanka Electricity Company, which is also a government-owned company, which controls about 15% of the distribution. And there are many independent power producers, small as well as large, which provides about 40% of the generation capacity. Currently, we have about 3,600 installed capacity, and the peak demand is around 2,100 megawatts. So we have hydros and coal are the main sources of energy, 35% each, and we have a little bit of oil and small power producers such as small hydro, wind and solar. So we have 5.5 million consumers, and the entire country is already almost electrified. More than 95% of the country is electrified, and we have at the moment more capacity than what we need. We can meet the demand, so no power deficit situation. So the challenges we have are, number one, the energy security, number two, price stability to the future, and number three, to improve the quality of and reliability of electricity supply and services, because now we have access to all, but everybody has access to electricity. So the next step is to improve the quality and reliability. So let me talk about the legal aspects. Currently we have the generation license is required for all generators, but there is a clause which mandate that any generator about 25 megawatts should have a share determined by the government. So government should have a share. It can be zero, it can be some percentage. And then all the generation requirements need to be identified in the long-term generation expansion plan, and only competitive bidding is allowed for selecting a generation station. So transmission is basically confined to Ceylon Electricity Board by law. No one else can get a transmission license. And the distribution also, there are licenses required, and there are four licenses for Ceylon Electricity Board and one for LECO. And any private company can obtain distribution license, but there should be a majority government share in that, a government or government-owned corporation. So market risk is minimum, because it's a single buyer model, government guaranteed almost all the contracts today, and minimum dispatch requirements are there, and the full supply risk is basically kept with the Ceylon Electricity Board, which means it is with the government. So operator viability and rights legally ensured, because there are many international players also operating in Sri Lanka. So it is required to allow recovery for all reasonable cost of a licensee under law. So as regulator, we need to provide that guarantee. All the reasonable costs should be recovered by the licensees. And minimum fixed return on investment as per the power purchase agreement, and stringent procedure to issue enforcement orders, and revocation of license is difficult, which provides certainty. So it's minister's concurrence, public notice, various other safeguards for investors. And this particular legal and regulatory framework what we have in Sri Lanka is basically inward looking, looking at the Sri Lanka market, not the participation of cross-border electricity trade or trading with other countries. So open access would attract investment but require amendments to the law. Handling and trading related dispatch is in the event of an international trading, because it's a single buyer model, this legal framework is not geared for international cross-border trading at the moment. So there need to be some modifications, amendments to the law in order to accommodate this. And also private parties that intend to invest for generation more than 25 megawatts will have a government share. So all these are looking at the Sri Lanka market only, this law was made. So if we look at improving the energy security, the price stability, and also even though we don't have any deficit situation right now, in future we may experience that, because the demand is growing and there are no much hydropower remaining in the country for harnessing. So we have to depend on the thermal power as well as the renewable energy. And let me quickly go through this India-Sri Lanka HVDC transmission link, which have been in discussion for more than a decade now. A pre-feasibility was done in 2002 and 2006, originally planned for 500 megawatt, upgradable to 1000 megawatt. Agreement signed to conduct detailed feasibility study between Power Grid of India and Ceylon Electricity Board. So it's a connection from Madurai in India to Anuradhapura in Sri Lanka. It's a 285 kilometer long line with 50 kilometer undersea cable and 400 kilovolts, and USD 800 million was the estimated cost at that time. I don't know what it would be today. So this is about 7-8 years back, the investment calculation. So the opportunities is that we see power deficits at various time intervals. We experience it in India, we experience it in Sri Lanka a while earlier. Now we are okay, but in future we may face that situation. So there are a lot of transmission network developments happening in India, and very attractive green prices observed in Indian power exchange as well as in Sri Lanka also. There are very low price power is available at some points of time. And potential savings in the spinning reserve reduction on both sides. And in Sri Lanka, there are a few large power plants planned 2020 beyond, inclusive of Sampur coal power project, which is a joint venture with Indian NTPC, and there is another coal power plant of 600 megawatts to be commissioned in 2022. And Sri Lanka has a very low off-peak. So we have more power than what we need during the off-peak hours, and some of the plants find it very difficult to be operated during that time, especially the coal plants. And also Sri Lanka has a high potential of renewable energy, solar and wind, in the northern part, which is very close to the Indian borders, and with a very small system of 3000 megawatts, we may not be able to harness that renewable energy and use it internally, though it is available. So the renewable energy generation is limited at this point of time, because we have almost reached the limits of absorption, and our plan is to have about 20% of generation by 2020 through the non-conventional renewable energy, that is not considering the large hydros. So all depends on the India-Sri Lanka policy. So to summarize, Sri Lanka electricity law and regional interconnection, open access is not allowed. All trading has to go through CEB transmission single licensing system, and all this generation procurement to be included in the long-term generation expansion plan. I repeat, all these are looking at Sri Lanka only. So for what we have discussed over the last few hours and yesterday, and to be discussed today and tomorrow, we need to have some legislative changes and regulatory framework changes in order to accommodate such interconnections to Sri Lanka. Thank you.